Throughout history, billions of dollars worth of artwork has been stolen from museums worldwide, sending authorities on wild goose chases. It can take decades to recover the material, if ever. Such was the case in Stockholm. What seemed like a simple robbery on the surface would, in fact, become one of the most elaborate heists in history. Stockholm wasn't the only target, either. Even Da Vinci's Mona Lisa and Munch's The Scream were taken. So how did these heists go down? And how did one fierce FBI agent recover $300 million worth of stolen artwork? The answer might surprise you. Housing world-famous near-priceless art right in the middle of the Swedish capital since 1866, this is the Stockholm National Museum, also known as the National Museum of Fine Arts. For close to a century and a half, the museum went about its business as usual. Little did they know that their cherished artwork would soon become the centerpiece of the heist of the century. With close to 500,000 pieces of valuable art, highlighted by numerous Rembrandt works, it might sound like the museum is enormous. However, it's significantly smaller than museums like the Met in New York and the Louvre in Paris, only welcoming 350,000 visitors annually. That significantly lower foot traffic would prove crucial to the notorious heist that would strike in the year 2000. So this heist, one that mystified authorities and sent a message to all future thieves, how did it all go down? The date was December 22, 2000, about 5 minutes before the 5 p.m. closing time. One man wielding a submachine gun walked in the front door to the entrance lobby, while his two accomplices had been suddenly already inside, secretly wielding pistols. Since they had intimidating weapons, holding up the guards was easy. With one man keeping watch, the others could strut past security, take what they wanted, and unless a guard decided to become a hero and put his own life on the line, there was no way they could be stopped. Once they were in, they acted with haste. They took the paintings they wanted, unimpeded by the intimidated guards, and then fled. How did the thieves get away? Well, since Stockholm is built on an archipelago and the museum is flanked on both sides by water, they used the most logical, quickest, and most unexpected getaway vehicle, a small motorboat. Now, as you can see, on the surface, it seemed like a very basic, straightforward plan. In reality, however, there was a lot more planning to it, and plenty was happening behind the scenes to make it all possible. If you were planning to rob a museum or a bank or even your local convenience store, what could immediately foil your plan? Police interference. That's why the three men of the Stockholm heist created a cunning distraction. In order to send police resources away from the scene of the crime, the robbers had planted explosives on two cars on the other side of town. That wasn't all. It was only a matter of time before the museum alarm sounded, and when it did, the first responders' cars discovered that their tires had been slashed, rendering them useless. Simultaneously, other accomplices were laying spikes on the roads around the museum, delaying police further and giving the thieves valuable time to take whatever they pleased. And what they pleased turned out to be three paintings by world-famous artists, in total worth upwards of $36 million, according to NPR. One of the three was a self-portrait piece from 1630 by Rembrandt, while the others were well-known Renoir paintings. This one, called Conversation with the Gardener, which had been in the collection since about 1920, and this one, called Young Parisian. Despite having clear intentions on what they wanted to steal and how they were going to do it, it was initially unclear why they stole the paintings. Considering that each work of art is almost instantly recognizable, it meant that they were too distinctive to be resold on regular markets. What art buyer would want to hang a stolen piece on their wall that would be seized by police at first sight? And as for the black market? Well, the police were keeping as close an eye as ever on it after the heist went down. But then, not too long after the paintings disappeared, the motive became clear. The museum received a ransom note sent by the thieves, demanding $3 million from the National Museum in Stockholm. Of course, the museum couldn't afford this, nor did they want to pay it. So the perpetrators were left with expensive paintings, no way to sell them, and no money. If you're wondering why the thieves specifically targeted that museum, one of the most famous in the city, they had good reason. First of all, because it was such an old museum, the building opened in 1866, remember, the security systems were far from state-of-the-art. It makes a difference that this robbery occurred in Europe as well, as opposed to the United States. Since European countries have open borders and are very close to one another, the opportunity to flee the country, both for the criminal and for the art they stole, is much higher. That's why there are less armed robberies of art in the United States than in Europe, according to FBI expert Robert Whitman. Special Agent Whitman has also stated that it's much more difficult to get through the security system at the Met or at the Louvre than it is to get in through a small house museum. Plus, as the first robbery of its kind with a water vehicle getaway, the police had no precedent in action to stop them. Normally, recovering every single piece of stolen artwork from a heist is extremely rare. They're usually destroyed, sold, or never found. From the Stockholm heist, however, it was a different story, thanks to that of one man, Robert Whitman. Whitman spent close to 20 years working with the FBI's National Art Crimes Team, assigned to the Philadelphia Field Division from 1988 to 2008, and throughout his distinguished career managed to recover more than $300 million worth of stolen artwork, a large chunk of which can be attributed to the Stockholm heist. This guy knew what he was doing, and that's why he managed to recover the three Stockholm pieces all within the space of 5 years. 5 years might sound like a long time, however, that's how long it took the thieves to find someone willing to buy their stolen Rembrandt self-portrait. The only problem, and a monumental one at that, was that the buyer was Robert Whitman. Without a flurry of buyers eager to flock out for the self-portrait, Robert was able to pretend to be a legitimate buyer and set up a deal to obtain the piece, which the thieves were trying to sell at Copenhagen Hotel for $500,000. After some negotiation, Whitman sealed the deal for just $250,000, a bargain for something worth tens of millions. 4 years prior to that, the police uncovered Renoir's conversation with the gardener, hidden in a bag during a completely unrelated drug raid. As for the third painting, the FBI didn't release details, but it did report that it was found in Los Angeles, of all places, before Rembrandt's self-portrait, making the negotiated sale the last piece of the puzzle. So what happened to the criminals then? Well, it didn't take long before they were caught. In total, 8 men received sentences for their part in the crime. 2 of them, Alexander Petrov and Stefan Nordstrom, were sentenced to 6.5 years and 6 years behind bars respectively for aggravated robbery, while 3 others were dealt up to 4 years in prison for complicity to theft, meaning that they were involved in some stage of the ordeal. On top of that, they were ordered to pay the museum 320 million kronor, about $30 million US, in damage. As for the remainder of those charged, they too received prison time for handling stolen goods. While that was certainly one of the most notorious heists of the century, there were many before it that made shockwaves just as big, if not bigger. The difference, and the exceptionally rare factor, is that all of the artwork was recovered for Stockholm. In Boston, it was another story. At the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum, 2 men dressed up as fake police officers, wax mustaches included, and rang the doorbell, falsely responding to a noise complaint. The night watchman let them in and quickly realized his mistake, eventually tied up in the basement with a second security guard. The thieves spent an hour completing what would become the most valuable theft of private property ever, escaping with 13 works of art worth an estimated $500 million, headlined by the only copy of Rembrandt's The Storm on the Sea of Galilee, valued in excess of $100 million alone. While the FBI was able to find their men, to this day, the art from the 1990 heist remains unrecovered, and the mystery of its whereabouts carries on. If you find it, there's still a $10 million reward on offer. Almost 80 years earlier, we witnessed another spectacular heist. Thankfully, however, the piece that was stolen was recovered. Perhaps the most famous painting in the world, Leonardo da Vinci's Mona Lisa. Back in 1911, the iconic art was stolen from the Louvre in Paris. It wasn't at the hands of an elaborate plan involving getaway boats or anything of that nature. Rather, a local handyman who worked at the Louvre named Vincenzo Perugia simply hid in a closet overnight, then tucked the painting underneath his smock and walked out. Even though the museum was closed and the doors were locked, a plumber was nearby to let him out. The fact that an in-house worker stole the painting isn't all that surprising. In fact, according to Robert Whitman and the FBI, 90% of art heists in the United States are done in-house. In other words, someone already with access to the building and the collection. Amazingly, it took a whole 24 hours before anyone noticed that the Mona Lisa was missing. But once it was noticed, it became international news. It took 2 years for her to be found, and as we've seen before, it was because the thieves were trying to sell it. An art dealer in Florence, Italy, received a letter from someone, Vincenzo Perugia, wanting to sell the Mona Lisa. That was all that was needed for the police to find their man, who astoundingly only landed 7 months in jail for the crime. Right up there alongside the Mona Lisa in the international art spotlight is The Scream by Edvard Munch, an iconic painting that was also stolen back in 2004. This heist, however, was a little more violent. Two thieves, armed with guns and wearing ski masks, hit up the Munch Museum in Norway with the beloved Scream painting as their main target, alongside another painting called The Madonna. After the museum couldn't meet the thieves' ransom demands, they were stuck with the artwork. Fast forward 2.5 years, and just like the Stockholm case, a British police officer posed as an art buyer, leading to the criminal's arrest. That's all for how the FBI recovered artwork from the heist of the century. If you were going to organize a heist, how would you do it? Let us know in the comments. Make sure to like this video, subscribe to The Richest, and join our notification squad. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time.